Hello, this is Richard Jacobs from the Future Tech Podcast. I have Lindsay Jessima.
You're listening to the Future Tech Podcast with Richard Jacobs. Future technologies such as artificial intelligence, stem cells, 3D printing, gene editing, Bitcoin, blockchain, the microbiome,
thanks so much for having me. I'm excited to be here.
Virtual reality and exploring space are much closer than you might think. In fact, many early versions of these technologies are in play right now. And the companies that are using these technologies are the focus of this podcast. My goal for you, the listener, is to learn from these podcasts.
You may very well learn something
that may change the course of your life for the better, steer you towards a new career, or give you insight into addressing a thorny medical problem. Remember, this podcast and its content is informational in nature only. No medical, tax, legal, financial, or psychological advice is being given. If you've enjoyed the podcast, please listen, subscribe,
my background is as a marketer, specifically more recently as a content marketer. So I think twofold. One is that, you know, if you look back to blogging not all that long ago, it started as something that hobbyists were doing, kind of an online journal, if you will, a weblog is how it even got the name. And slowly over time, that turned into something that brands started to do, and then everybody started to do, and now everybody has a podcast. And the ones that really stand out are those that are creating really, really good content and that are using it as part of a fully integrated content marketing program, right? To really reach and resonate with their audiences and really deliver value in ways that's meaningful. And so we are in the midst of that next movement with podcasting. So podcasts, just like blogs, started as something that hobbyists would do more than 10 years ago, almost 15 years ago now, the first podcast came out. And since then, it's been something that people kind of do on their own time because they want to. And over the last few years, brands have started to pick up on that. And now, depending on where you look and what your perspective is, it's starting to feel like everybody's starting to get a podcast. And just like with blogging and email before that, and still is true today, those that stand out are the ones that are doing it well, that are creating really, really great content, not just doing a podcast for podcast's sake, that are doing it with the audience in mind, with storytelling and meaningful, value-rich content, and that are really leveraging that podcast in ways far beyond just hitting publish and, you know, sharing a little bit on social media, but really going and saying, what else can we do with this? How else can we leverage it? So I think those are the ones that are really standing out today.
Well, that's the big question. So, you know, everyone's learned, all right, do a podcast, obviously get good guests, ask good questions, and then publish it on 8 million different places. But then what? How do you get attention to it? How do you grow it? How do you leverage it from there?
Yeah, exactly. Well, and that's exactly the question that we are working to answer, which is then what, right? So speaking from experience in my past life before I started Casted, as I mentioned before, I was a B2B marketer and I had a podcast and we worked really hard. I had the luxury of having a really talented team and some great agencies to work with. And we worked really hard to create great content and to publish it and to share it on social media. But we were so future oriented, so constantly under the gun to meet that next deadline on, yes, more podcasts, but also blog posts, white papers, web content, case studies, all of the other content that we were responsible for. We were constantly thinking about the next thing, that it's difficult to pause and to manually go back into that show that you created and say, what else can we do with it? How can we extract more value? How can we get more out of it? How can we pull clips and really, really drive more and more value and leverage this show for all that it's worth? So with Casted, that's what we're doing. We're making it easier for marketers to do that and having it not be so manual so that they can get into those shows, get into those conversations like you and I are having right now and say, okay, what clips can we pull? How can we highlight certain areas? How can we leverage the transcript version of this show to create written content? How can we use this conversation in myriad ways to just really wring out all of the value possible from, you know, the starting point?
Okay. So, you know, any specific examples or case studies, you know, you can generate a transcript. Again, you can do clips from a podcast with a great guest, but again, what do you do with them? It sounds like from what you're saying, each podcast ideally needs to be marketed and broke it up into pieces, and it you need to market to get people to listen to, let's say, each podcast itself. But again, what's an example of doing that well?
Yeah, so I can tell you a use case, right? So kind of a before and after. So what I would have done before is have this conversation. I would record this podcast and I would go on and I would, let's say I was the host. So I'd record this show and I would go and I'd get it to my team and we would edit it and we would produce it and we would publish it and we would promote it on social media and then we'd be on to the next thing, right? And then now with Casted, I can instead record this conversation, make it into a great podcast episode, and then it gets pulled into Casted and I can immediately get a transcript that I can go into and much easier, much faster, much more efficiently pull written content. So I can pull the content that's already transcribed from that interview to as starter copy for a blog post, for show notes, for additional supplemental content, for BDR cadences, and for I can take that transcript and clean it up, and I can have it be a Q&A series. That transcript becomes part of a searchable database that I can go back to and much more easily reach back in time and grab content that already exists to repurpose it, to remix it, to resurface it, and use it for future campaigns. I'm also able to pull clips so that I can get into this conversation that we had and I can highlight certain areas that I think that my audience is really going to resonate with. And I can use those clips on social media. I can use them in that blog post that I created to make it much more interactive and more interesting. I can put it into my BDR cadences and inside sales emails to make those much more engaging. And instead of sharing the whole episode, I can share a clip that I really want to make sure that you hear. And then I can get much more from the analytics that we're creating. I can get more value out of how are people engaging with this? Did they listen to that clip? Did they go on to listen to some of the other clips that I shared? Did they listen to the whole episode? Did they go on and interact with some of the other resources that and content that I provided to them when I sent that clip? So it's taking really a top of funnel one way conversation where I record a podcast and I'm kind of talking at you while you listen to it and turning it into something that pulls people down into the funnel more and makes it more of an engaging two way conversation.
What is a BDR cadence, by the way?
I'm getting into industry jargon. Yeah. So inside sales, BDR would be business development representative, SDR would be sales development representative, all the same individual who spends their days in like a B2B organization doing outreach. So reaching out to people outside the organization, trying to say, hey, here's this information that I have. Can I set up a meeting? And quite often companies will set them up with cadences and, you know, marketing will work with them to have email campaigns and nurture streams to help them reach out to these people with information that's really valuable. So content like this would get shared in those email campaigns to help resonate with people that they're trying to reach out to.
So, all right, well, backing up a little bit. So your system automatically creates a transcript, or who is transcribing a given podcast?
Yeah. So every time you publish a podcast, the RSS feed is automatically pulled into Casted once you sign up and once you get it implemented. And then, yeah, every time you publish a show, it's pulled in and automatically transcribed.
By AI or by a human?
By AI. It's an API, Google Transcribe API.
Okay. Is Google Transcribe good enough to for the podcast to make sense, or is it still have trouble with some?
Yeah, it's pretty great. They are, let's see, it's not 100%. It's not quite where it would be if you or I sat there and listened to the whole thing and transcribed it by hand, but it's pretty darn close. And so for me, the use case that I recommend is saying, hey, start with it as a foundation and then go through and, you know, don't copy and paste the whole thing and use it as your blog post, but copy that content and use it as a starter to mold it, to build from there, to refine it. And it makes the job of the copywriter much easier and much more efficient, as opposed to starting from just straight up audio content.
So, all right. What's a typical publishing pace for podcast shows that you've interacted with? Is it one a week, more or less?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. I've seen some trends emerge. And a couple of years ago when I started in podcasting, I feel like there was kind of an expectation that you would do a weekly show, just one show a week, every single week, develop that consistency and that rhythm. But lately with the as podcasts have become more popular, more and more and more popular, I feel like there's more of a trend toward seasons or series, binge-worthy content, if you will. So where you'll have a series of 5 or maybe 10, somewhere in there, episodes chunked together around a given topic. And let's say you did a series on podcasts, right? And you could do a few shows around that and then take a little break and then do another series on something else that all falls under an umbrella that makes sense for your brand. Startup does this really well. Alex Bloomberg of Gimlet, his series called Startup, where they will do a series on different startups. He started with his own, with the actual formation of Gimlet. And then from there, he's kind of followed different startups as they get started and get going, but it all falls under the same theme of startups. So that's a theme or a format that I really like, because I think as a podcaster, it gives you some flexibility to take a break when you need to and to think in more finite chunks, as opposed to always and always, forever and ever, once a week, I'm going to do this show. So that's something that I've seen. But certainly you have to do what works best for your brand and what's going to be best for you and the kind of time that you have to allocate towards it.
Yeah, I've done long series on particular topics. I made one or two of them into books, but I guess I'm just making this up. You could do, I guess I would call it a master cast, where you take clips from, let's say you did 20 interviews on, you know, snoring, and you took all the clips of the best you know, things that were said about snoring from all these scientists and made a master cast with them all in there.
Mm-hmm.
You think that would be a good idea for promotion?
Yeah. I mean, like I said, you have to do what makes the most sense for one, for your listeners, for your audience. And, you know, there's a reason that saying is so common, you know your audience. What are they going to want to listen to? What's going to be really interesting for them to listen to? What's going to be engaging and a reward for them hitting play, right? And that's different for everyone. For some, you know, that's a really long podcast. For some, that's really, really short little bursts, but you don't really know until you try. So I think it's important to try something that you really believe your audience is going to enjoy and not only consume for themselves, but also share. And then watch and see what your metrics say.
Well, there's always examples out there of people that have done this well. So do you have any examples that come to your mind of really fantastic things that have been done? And what did you learn from seeing those examples? Maybe one or two.
Sure. So I give a couple examples. I mean, I mentioned Alex Bloomberg. And then there's also Guy Raz. Alex Bloomberg has Startup and all of Gimlet. Gimlet Media is his company. And then Guy Raz, This American Life. And How I Built This is one of my favorites. It's story. All of those share storytelling, right? And again, thinking with your audience in mind. It's never about what you want to say. It's all about what your audience wants to hear. That's paramount. Something more in the B2B podcasting space, Jay Akunzo has a show called Unthinkable, which I really like. Jay is a good friend and shares the same perspective on podcasting and show creation that I do. And he has some really, 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 really great insights on storytelling and resonating with the audience and not necessarily doing what everybody else is doing, but doing what's right for your brand. So I'm always quick to recommend his show. He's got some really, really great podcast content.
So what's the role of Castbit? Is it the mechanical, easy transcription, easy syndication part of it? Or is there, do you have technical or marketing experts for podcasters as part of the platform? Like what's the goal of it?
Sure. So we are a platform. So we are a software company. Right now, we are not leaning into the services component, but other than supporting our existing customers and just making the most out of their platform. But yeah, so basically, as I mentioned, the use case before, so it's all individuals who have a show already or who are just about to launch a show, and then they leverage Castbit to really wring out that content and get as much out of it as possible. So we work with B2B marketers that have a podcast, and they use us to, get right now as the MVP, is the very, very first stages of the platform stands. they pull in their show, they get a transcription. That transcription goes into a searchable database that helps them repurpose their content easier, helps them create clips quickly without having to go back to an audio engineer or any more technical individual. The marketer themselves can just pull clips and share them in myriad ways, and then start to get more visibility about engagement with their show.
So is Casted, is it ready? Is it running? Or is it coming in the near future? Okay, yep. So it's here now.
It is here now, yes.
Who would be a good fit for it? Who wouldn't? Is this just for new podcasters or big ones? Or
Sure. So it's parameters? Yeah. So it's designed for the B2B marketer, and we really work with those who already have a show or who are just about to do one. Since we right now are not focused on the actual production of a show, we work with those who already have a show, or we have lots of really great agency partners that can help produce the show, and then we can come alongside and help get as much value out of it as possible. But yeah, the B2B marketer, typically kind of in the mid-market to enterprise range size of the company, who has or is about to launch a podcast.
What about podcast networks? You know, once someone joins Casted, they say, hey, help me. You know, we want to grow this thing. We need expertise on how to market it, and maybe we want to join a network or something. What do they do? Do you say, hey, talk to so-and-so? Do you provide any expertise like that?
Mm-hmm. Well, we have some really great partners and some friends in the business, if you will, who do that, who do podcast tours, who do, like I mentioned, podcast agencies, who help with the production. And then really the hope is that when you're in Casted using the platform, that it helps you, like I mentioned, get as much possible, really wring all that content out of that show so that you're getting from one episode many pieces of content that will help you really have a louder voice and reach more people in more effective ways with starting with that one episode. So yeah, I mean, we have our nice kind of unofficial network, if you will, of partners and friends in the podcasting space that can help.
Very good. What's the best way for people to get in touch to try Casted and to ask you questions if they want to?
Yeah, I would love that. So our website is casted.us, so casted.us. And you can find me on LinkedIn. You can find my name. It's just kind of a tough one. Or you can look up Casted on LinkedIn. And it's probably the best way to find us.
All right. Well, Lindsay, thanks for coming. I really appreciate it.
Thanks so much for having me on the show.
You're listening to the Future Tech Podcast with Richard Jacobs. Future technologies such as artificial intelligence, stem cells, 3D printing, gene editing, Bitcoin, blockchain, the microbiome, quantum computing, virtual reality, and exploring space are much closer than you might think. In fact, many early versions of these technologies are in play right now, and the companies that are using these technologies are the focus of this podcast. My goal for you, the listener, is to learn from these podcasts. You may very well learn something that may change the course of your life for the better, steer you towards a new career, or give you insight into addressing a thorny medical problem. Remember, this podcast and its content is informational in nature only. No medical, tax, legal, financial, or psychological advice is being given. If you enjoyed the podcast, please listen, subscribe, like, and tell your friends about it. Thank you.